pulley armor plate.
Citizens, to an all-new episode of the Batcave podcast. It's your old bat chum John S. Drew here, and I'm joined in the bowels of the Batcave once again by the man with the plan from 13thdimension.com, Mr. Dan Greenfield. Hey, Dan.
Hi, John.
So here we are in the Batcave looking at the Batcomputer, and I pulled up another file, and we're continuing our talks here about this upcoming Batman 66 exhibit. And you've brought along someone special to talk about that exhibit with us tonight.
Yeah, a return engagement, none other than Burt Ward himself. Robin the Boy Wonder is here with us to talk about the upcoming exhibit, which will be at the Hollywood Museum. There's going to be a special VIP gala on January 10th, and then the exhibit will open to the public on January 12th, which is the 52nd anniversary of the premiere of the show. You can find out information at thehollywoodmuseum.com. But, Bert, thanks for joining us on the show today.
Hello, citizens!
So, Bert, we had Wally Winger last week here on the podcast, and he immediately pointed to you when he said, you know, in terms of the origin of this exhibit. So, kicking it right off, tell us about your involvement and how this came together for you.
Well, actually, I would love to take credit, but I have to give credit to my wife, Tracy. This was her idea as a tribute to our dear friend, Adam West. And as the whole concept evolved, it also, from the owner of the Hollywood Museum and our press agent, Roger, they kind of evolved it to where they made it as not only a tribute to Adam, but a tribute to me as well. And in fact, kind of like a tribute to all the villains and villainesses and everybody involved in the production of Batman. And it really is going to be an spectacular exhibit. I mean, they've got so much stuff. I mean, and they're creating entire areas of the whole Batman, you know, city, so to speak, with Wayne Manor, Commissioner Gordon's office. They've got some wonderful ideas. I haven't seen it yet, but I do know they have, from all over the country, gotten people who have built up these collections over many, many years. And they've got all of this stuff on loan to the museum. And it's just an enormous amount of stuff. And I think it's going to be really terrific.
Now, you worked on the show with 3 seasons. It ended nearly 50 years ago. Did it ever at any point cross your mind that someday it would be a museum exhibit?
Well, I never thought of myself as a prehistoric, ancient, you know, artifact. I'm not sure I want to go there. But it was such a huge hit. It's always been such a hit. And, you know, there's so many people that I meet in these appearances when I go across the country that say things like, God, I grew up watching this show, and I could have turned out not such a good person. And believe it or not, from watching your show, I ended up going into law enforcement, or I ended up doing something that was very positive instead of something negative. So literally millions and millions of people were positively affected by our show. Just like I would not have expected, you know, to there be a, you know, a museum that dedicates this exhibit. I wouldn't have also expected that Adam and I would be submitted to the Guinness Book of Records as the only 2 actors in history that worked together 50 years later. Right. I mean, there's just some amazing things. If you'd said to me 3 years ago, you know, someday they'll have these casinos will have one-armed bandits that are 11 and a half feet tall with your images twice your normal size on them, I wouldn't have believed that. A year ago, if you'd said to me, well, Bert, you know, I think they're going to come out with a Batman pinball machine that they're going to want you and Adam to record more than 300 lines of dialogue for the pinball machine. And this pinball machine is going to be so spectacular that not only does it play HD television stereophonic sound, but it has a projector that projects the bat signal on your ceiling. I wouldn't have believed all that, but guess what? It's all true.
Now, Bert, did you contribute anything to the exhibit itself? Was there anything that you had in your private collection that, people are going to be able to see at this?
Well, there were actually two costumes, okay? They do have one of my costumes from the show that actually was from the studio. But I also had a costume at the time that I made up. And the reason why I did that is because even though I had six costumes on the show, using those for fight scenes, these fight scenes every day, the collars would get messed up, you know, this or that. And it just, I wanted to always have one that looked really spiffy, you know what I mean?
Sure.
So in close shots that I could use my own suit. And so I didn't actually lend that to the museum because I still wear it for very special moments, like private moments with my wife. Although I must tell you, she looks better in the costume than I do.
Oh, okay.
In any event, we all have a lot of fun, and I do have some recorded stuff I've done for the museum. One of the really spectacular things, I don't know if you guys have seen our new movie, you know, Batman versus Two-Face.
Oh, yeah.
But
oh, yeah, we've talked about it. Sure, absolutely.
Did you have a chance to look at the special features on the DVD?
Yeah.
Have you seen that yet? Did you see
yes.
that spectacular surprise that Warner Brothers did for me called The Wonderful World of Burt Ward?
I love the Superman and Superboy comic books. At age 3, I had my own towel around my neck, holding that towel up, and wanted to be Superman. I never saw the Batman comic book. Adam and I brought to life that comic book. We did something different with Batman. We actually took a script, played it straight with all kinds of subtle double meanings. We put on our tights to put on the world.
I was just so blown away, so unexpected. I always expect that when I do a recording for a movie that they'll have me come in and, you know, afterwards and do some interviews just, you know, for some bonus material. But when I went in for the interview after doing the recording, instead of it being like 15 or 20 minutes, it was 2.5 hours.
Wow, nice.
And I was saying, why are they asking me so many questions, you know? And they just did this fantastic tribute, and I couldn't thank them 10,000 times over for such a wonderful thing. And it talks about my special friendship with Adam, talks about how we would sometimes on the weekends go out and play tennis together, and how our families got along well. And it was just, you know, it was just wonderful. And it also talked about what Adam would say when we would come out at these, you know, we do all these comic cons, you know that, guys.
Right.
And
yep.
We talk to thousands and thousands of people, and we would do these talks, you know, where they call it a panel, and we come out and for about 45 minutes, sometimes as long as an hour, answer questions. And Adam and I would always kid each other. But one of the things that Adam did that was just so unique and hilarious was that after I was introduced, they'd introduce me first, and people would clap, and I'd come out and wave hi to everybody. And then they would say, introduce Adam, and he'd come out, and everybody's cheering. And then he would come out with a line like this. He'd say, "Ladies and gentlemen, I'm just going to stand here a few extra moments and allow you to gaze at my incredible crime-fighting physique." And people start giggling and giggling. And he says, "You know, I'm 88 years old, and would you like to know how I stay in such incredible crime-fighting shape. And everybody's like, yeah, what? He says, every morning I have a bowl of Burt Ward's Gentle Giant's dog food. And that keeps me in great shape. And, you know, people in the audience, they are crying. They're laughing so hard. And his timing was perfect. It always was. A man was a genius with timing. And in comedy, timing is very important. So, and the thing, the irony, though, there's an irony to all this. And that is, and I know we've talked about it on your show before. You know, we have our Gentle Giant's dog food, and we have dogs living 2 and 3 times their normal lifespan, up to 27 years. And the irony for me is that I would have given anything if my dog food could have helped my dear friend Adam live twice as long, because I would love to have him another 88 years on this planet.
Yeah. Now, Burt, I want to talk some more about the dog food in a moment, but I got to also say, because you talk about timing and comedy, and I don't know if we've told you this before, but we've said it on the podcast, your timing when it comes to comedy on the series was fantastic. There are little scenes like when Adam said to you as Batman and you're Robin, he says, stay on your toes. And it was like, without a thought, you lifted yourself up onto your, and I
cried
every time.
We did that all the time. Yeah, we, you know, because we had so much fun, number one, and number two, we had a chemistry. I'm not sure I've ever seen a chemistry like Adam and I had of working together. You know, he was so stoic in his presentation, you know. I mean, all the time people would ask me, is he really like that in person? Is he really? And I say, he's exactly like that in person. You know, that I mean, and, you know, it's so wonderful because he thought of himself in such grand ways. You know what I mean? He kind of like thought of himself like Winston Churchill. You know what I mean? Or, I mean, I remember he told me about the 3 B's, the 3 famous B's. And I said, what do you mean the 3 B's? Well, there's Bond, Beatles, and Batman.
Yeah.
And I said, oh, yeah, okay, all right, I got that. And one of the real cappers was when he he told me that he really understood what it was like, okay, to play Batman. When he watched Charlton Heston play Moses and part the Red Sea, oh, my God, how big can you be? I said, oh, my God, Adam. You know what I mean? And he's dead serious about that. And it was so funny because in keeping with his stoic, grand, very slow talking pace, I was just that much faster and quicker and just the opposite. And I really believe that what makes great comedy is great contrast. You know, all the greatest, you know, comic teams, Abbott and Costello, Laurel and Hardy, Ed McMahon and Johnny Carson, all of these people had a commonality of contrast. And Adam and I were ultimately contrast. Because he would, you know, and it's so funny because, you see, his theory of acting was, you have to understand, a very smart man. He knew we had a 30-minute television show. You understand? Right. He knew there was 8 minutes of commercials. He knew that the maximum amount of time of on-air appearance was about 22 minutes. He also understood the concept that if he spoke really slowly, that their camera would have to be on him longer. And so why do you think he would say, well, Robin, you know? He's holding that camera on him because he knows the more the camera's on him, the less it's on somebody else. So he would jump in on my line. Like, for example, I would have a simple line like, gosh, you're right, Batman. And he would have this long, drawn-out speech. And after his long, drawn-out speech, I'd say, yes, you're right. And he'd jump in, yes, Robin. And another thing. And he'd go into this very slow. Or we'd be doing a two-shot. and we'd be talking, and the camera's like on the two of us, and he would turn and walk right into the camera, completely filling the space. All you could see was a close-up of his face. The director would say, no, no, cut. You can't do that, Adam. You're going to have both of you in the shot. He said, no, no, I have to do it. He said, what do you mean you have to do it? He says, because of the moment. It needed it. He would go round and round. And I understood, Adam. I understood exactly what I was dealing with, you know? And we got along really well. We had fun.
Now, Bert, you yourself have sometimes been accused of being a bit of a hot dog. And as it turns out, of course, on the Tuesday before the event, there's going to be a hot dog named for you at Pink's, yes. The legendary hot dog stand in Los Angeles. Well, why don't you tell us about that? Because that's got to be really exciting.
Well, it's one of these things. It's an honor to have a super wiener named after you. And you know,
keep going.
The whole concept of this pink hot dog. I mean, they're so well known on the West Coast, just like sure. Nathan's hot dogs on the East Coast. You know, and I thought I wanted to do something memorable. You know what I mean? We all want to make a kind of a lasting impression. So I've now come up with the idea that everybody that comes to this event, and gets one of my Burt Ward Robin the Boy Wonder hot dogs, that I am going to personally autograph every single hot dog with my initials and mustard. Now, this way, awesome. When they eat that hot dog, they will have that hot dog with them forever. Or mostly forever.
Right. Now do you know what the toppings are for the Burt Ward Robin the Boy Wonder hot dog?
Of course, I picked them. You don't know what they are?
No, let us have it. Tell us what they are.
Okay. Well, first I have is a full-size all-beef hot dog.
Of course.
It's got to be full-size. And it's going to have mustard, relish.
Of course.
It's going to have mustard, pickle, relish, and sauerkraut, and onions.
Mm. Perfect.
Okay.
Perfect.
Very, very good. And you know something? I can hardly wait to get my hot dog there. And it's really an honor. I mean, how many people can have a hot dog named after them, right?
That is truly a triumph. That is for sure.
Yes. Very inspiring. So I'm very excited about that. And oh, I'm going to arrive in the Batmobile, of course.
Nice.
You know, and yeah, my wife Trace and I are going to ride in the Batmobile into the event, and we're really looking. There's going to be a terrific turnout of people there, and we're going to have a lot of fun. And that is the day before this museum exhibit. Well, it's the premiere that I'm going to. That
right.
They have a special thing, and I understand that you guys are going to be coming to it, huh?
Yeah, is that true? We're going to be flying out there for it. And
wow, that is an honor. Let me tell you something. I have to say there's so many people that wish they could be invited to that grand opening. It's mainly like, you know, Hollywood celebs and stuff like that. And the actual premiere when it opens to the public is going to be on the 12th of January, which
right.
is exactly 52 years after the premiere of our series.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, and in fact, I'm going to try. My plane lands on Tuesday morning, so I'm hoping to go right from the airport to Pink's. So I hope to catch your hot dog in action.
Yes, I'm sure you will. And you know something? We're going to have a wonderful, wonderful time there. I mean, you know, everybody likes to eat hot dogs. And I just thought, what an incredible honor. This will always be, throughout all future history, a wonderful hot dog that people can enjoy and think of the Batman TV series.
Yeah. Now, you recently also got to ride the Batmobile in the Hollywood Bowl Parade, didn't you?
Yes, the Hollywood Christmas Parade.
Right, the Christmas Parade.
Yeah, my wife, Tracy, and I rode in the Batmobile, and we had the best time. I mean, it was It was just phenomenal. There was such a huge turnout. I had no idea. I don't know how many tens of thousands of people there. It's just amazing. For I don't know how many miles it was that we drove, and everywhere you went, everywhere we drove, we looked on both sides, and just packed all the way from the curb to the buildings. Got to be 20 some odd feet, packed everywhere. And when we'd make a turn on a street, it would be like 50 people deep, you know, on the curb. Just a huge turnout. And it was televised. It was just a lot of fun. We had a great time, and people were screaming, "Hello, Robin," and all this kind of stuff. Well, one person held up our bag of our dog food and says, "My dog eats Gentle Giants." And, you know, it was just everybody was so warm, and it was just a great time. It was, and they had so many guests there and so many, oh, my gosh, the floats and it was a spectacular event.
Wow.
That's terrific.
Now, the dog food. I mean, we talked about it the last time as well, Gentle Giants dog food. I have two dogs that are on the diet. In fact, they take both the hard food and the soft food. We do a little mixing of the soft food in the bowl with the hard food.
Oh, that's exactly the way you should. Yeah. The way you should. And by the way, two interesting things have happened since we last talked. We are now, our dog food is distributed into 700 Stop and Shop grocery stores.
Nice.
And also Giant grocery stores. And then also into Big Y, which is in Massachusetts and Connecticut. So the 13 East Coast states now have our food. And, you know, we have all kinds of promotions running or discounts and stuff on it. And I don't know if you know this, but I think you do. You know, my wife and I take no salary from this. This is pure charity for us.
Right.
But we actually sell our food at cost. I mean, we don't make anything from it. We have no employees. And we're so proud that we can have a food that dogs can live as long as 27 years and yet retails for half the price of what you would pay in a pet store. And that's our motto now, half the price and twice the life. And that's our Gentle Giants dog food in, like I said, Stop and Shops, Giant stores, and Big Y. And we're just thrilled. And then now another thing, next month, starting in February, we are now going to be in every Walmart supercenter in the country. So we're going to be in something like 1,556 of these Giant supercenters. And then we're also going into Walmart in Canada. So all of this, and again, our whole goal is to help every dog live the longest, healthiest, happiest life possible. That's our goal. And my wife, something else, something new for you guys. I don't know if you've checked out our Facebook page recently, but we have Gentle Giants Dog Food and Products, our Facebook page. And my wife, Tracy, has been getting so many letters from people. And, you know, they write in, they send pictures and videos of their dogs and all this stuff. And she has actually started advertising on the internet. And we have now gone from, well, when she started last January, there was like 175 followers. And then she started first just answering emails and stuff like that. And then we went to 65,000. And now, since the last 3 weeks that she's just actually put things out for people in a big way, we've gone from 65,000 followers to almost 500,000.
Wow.
I mean, that's like pretty amazing, you know, and we're just so thrilled. And you know, I'll tell you something. I've learned a really great lesson in life I'd like to share with you guys. And that is this, you know, it's wonderful to accomplish great things. And my wife and I are thrilled that in our lives we have. But you know something? We actually have more fun doing charity work and helping others than doing things for ourselves. We actually have more fun doing it. When people call and they tell us, like, their dog, they thought they were going to have to put their dog down. They start feeding them the Gentle Giants food, and now the dog is, like, miraculously recovering. You know, things even that we find almost amazing and hard to believe. But all of these things, we're doing such a good thing, and we feel so good because we love people and we love the idea of animals living longer lives. Because, you know, I'll tell you something. You have your dogs there. You know It's not just the fact that your dogs can live 5 or 10 years longer, but what will it do for your own life?
Yeah.
And your own happiness with your family to have your canine kids with you for another 5 or 10 years longer.
No, you're right. You're right. And speaking of the internet, I just also, we talked about this when we were setting up the interview. You can get the dog food on Amazon, but even more importantly, because my wife and I were thrilled.
We actually stopped Amazon because they were double charging people. What would happen is we're on Walmart.com, Chewy.com, PetSmart.com.
Yep.
Yes, Chewy.com, Walmart.com, and PetSmart.com. Walmart's had a little bit of a problem every so often keeping up with it because they sell out almost immediately. And when they would do that, Amazon would double the price. So we decided we're not going to do that. We want all of our people that use our food to be able to get our food at the same price. And, right. and you know, we take nothing from it to begin with.
Right.
So we just don't want to have anybody that was treated unfairly. So we have focused 100%. And now Walmart has now ordered tremendous amounts. So Walmart, Chewy.com, Walmart.com, and PetSmart have our food. And then combining that with being in all the Walmarts in the country, it won't be a problem getting our food anymore.
Right. Very
you know?
Nice.
And by the way, just so you know, to the stores, we started back in 2005. Okay. And here it is, 2018. That's 13 years. We've never raised our prices to the store in 13 years. I think we're probably the only product in America that sells at the original price it sold for, and we take nothing from it. And I even go to my suppliers because they want to charge me more every year. I said, no, you got to do this. This is for charity. You got to do this for people who love their dogs that can't necessarily afford a lot of money. We want to make this affordable for everybody.
Right. That's fantastic.
Well, So we love our dogs. By the way, how are your dogs doing on our food?
Oh, they're doing fantastic. I mean, they're on the young side still. I've got a 3-year-old boxer lab mix and a 4-year-old. Well, we're not entirely sure. She might be an Australian shepherd dog, or she might be a Shibu Inu. I think they call it mix. But they're
right.
Great dogs. We rescued them both at the beginning of the year.
Wow. Well, I don't know if you recall this from the last conversation we had, but I think I had told you that it's now a year and a half ago that Inside Edition had come out to our house,
yes.
Filmed our rescue, and
they
had focused on one of our dogs, Tara, who a Russian wolfhound. She was only... they only normally live 7 to 9 years, but she was 25 years old, and this is a year ago June. I mean,
wow.
So it's a year and a half, a little more than a year and a half, and they put it out on their YouTube. It's on YouTube.com.
Yep.
If any of your listeners want to go see this, they just go to YouTube.com, type in 4 words, Inside Edition, Burt, B-U-R-T, Ward, W-A-R-D, and it pops up, and it says, 25-year-old dog, could this be the oldest living pooch in the world? Well, guess what? Today is the 3rd, and yesterday, the 2nd, she turned 27 years old.
Wow.
27. Yes. And that's more than triple her normal lifespan.
Right.
We don't have to, and my wife has also just recently done a video, don't give up on your dog, because, you know, we've had dogs that, And even this dog, I guess it was a year and a half ago, she had a problem getting up, and we took her to the vet, and the vet said, she's already twice her normal lifespan, almost 3 times, you know, let her die. And we said, no, not at all. And we didn't give up on her, and it turned out she was had just injured herself, and like a week or two later, she was running around again.
Right.
And that was like, two and a half years ago. I mean, so we've got this, my wife's got the wonderful video on, and our new website is gentlegiantsdogfood.com. That's our new website, www.gentlegiantsdogfood.com. But she has this wonderful thing about don't give up on your dog, because what's happened in today's world, veterinarians, and even if they're well-meaning, okay, they're so used to dogs only living 7, 8, 9 years in general. I mean, smaller dogs longer, but still that when your dog gets to that age, they think in terms of end of life, and they shouldn't. And we fight for the life of every one of our rescue dogs. We fight for everyone. And right now, I'm proud to tell you that here at our rescue, 24 of our dogs have 24 right now have already lived more than twice their normal lifespan. So that is consistency, not an anomaly.
Well, Bert, I can't speak much to dogs because I don't have any. You know, you had Catwoman on the show, and what you have here is a Catman, as I think I mentioned last time. So
we have on our website. Yeah, we have my wife dressed as Wonder Woman. I'm dressed as Robin, and our national sales manager is Catboy. When he was like, I don't know, 10 years or 12 years old or whatever it is. And we just have fun with it. You know, it's funny, too, when people call, and if they call me and they don't get me, they get my recording.
Yep.
And my recording, have you ever heard my recording?
Yes.
Oh, Goofy.
Yeah. My recording is Goofy. And it so happens that when I was in Toronto about, I guess 2 years ago, about a year and a half ago, it was August of 2016, I met a gentleman named Bill Farmer, who for the last 30 years has done the voice of Goofy for Disney. And he was kind enough to do a Goofy imitation, if you will, of answering my phone and mentioning something about that I was busy, and he was busy eating a bowl of Gentle Giant's dog food, and just the cutest thing in the world. And so many people are so caught off guard when they call and they finally reach me and they say, "What is this Goofy on your telephone doing?" You know, I said, "Am I answering my phone? Goofy was a dog."
That's great. Well, you gotta branch out into cats, Bert.
We are coming.
Oh, are you
coming this summer? A whole line of cat food, and you know what spurred us to do that? I'll tell you something. We like to only get involved with what we really know. Well, we have had a number of cats. We do rescue, and if you really are into rescue, you'll just about rescue anything. We've even rescued horses. You know, we rescued a pigs. We rescued a sheep. I mean, if you're the kind of person that saves lives, that's your nature. So anyway, we had a lady, and this is about 23 years ago. We first moved where we're living, and she had five or six cats that I think were probably about 4 or 5 years of age. And five to eight years old, my wife is saying. Okay, and these were feral cats, you know. And if they went to a shelter, they would get put down because they wouldn't be adopted, because being feral, they weren't, you know, really acclimated to humans. So this lady who had the feral cat said, "You know, you've got this big building here. Why don't you let these cats live in your big building? And you'll never even know they're there for 5 or 6 months." And we said, "You know, we don't want to, you know, lose any life. We don't want to see the cats die. Okay, put them in our building." Because we also go in our building, and when we first get dogs in, we use that as kind of an area that we separate dogs when they first come in, so we got to make sure they're not sick before you bring them in with all of our dogs, because our dogs all live in our house.
Of course.
But they first have to be separated to make sure there's no illness. Anyway, the long and short of it is, we fed the cat food, but we noticed that they weren't eating much of the regular cat food. But somehow, because we also had dogs in the building when they first come in for 2 weeks, these cats were eating our dog food.
Yep.
And we recently lost two of them. One was 31 years of age and the other was 32 years of age.
Wow.
Which is considered astronomically long for cats. Now, we've been doing more research, and we have decided we're going to modify our existing food to make it more designed for cats, but it's basically the same dry and canned food. And let me tell you something. If we can help people who have cats have their cats live as long as ours, you know, there'll be the same kind of thing. Everything is based on nutrition, science, and with a loving attitude towards all animals.
Wow. That's fantastic, because my cat now eats the wet food.
Let me tell you. Oh, absolutely. And I'll tell you something. If you end up getting our wild-caught Alaskan salmon, that is the That wild-caught Alaskan salmon is the most expensive salmon in the world. In fact, it is so expensive, they don't even sell it in most grocery stores for humans because you'd have to pay four times the amount. But we get that for our dogs. And you bet. I have one lady that operates a cat rescue. She doesn't even have a dog. And she gets four cases. That means there's 12 in a case. That's
right.
48 cans a week.
Jeez.
That she's feeding to her, I don't know how many cats she has, probably 50 or more.
Wow.
But they love our food. Every week she gets that. So we know we're on to something good. Again, it's all part of a program, though, of how you feed your dog or cat, how you, you know, do all of the things, multiple, smaller, more frequent meals, you know, all of these things, elevated feeders, all of the things that we do for dogs, we're going to apply the same principle for cats because we've seen it's already working.
Wow. So you really are the Cape Crusader to the Canine Crusader.
Right.
I love that.
And now with my new movie out, with the two movies, you know, Batman, Return of the Cape Crusader came out a year ago, and Batman versus Two-Face came out first week in October. You know, I'm not only from Cape Crusader to Canine Crusader, back to Cape Crusader.
Right.
So I'm wearing two hats, you know, both canine and cape.
Now, speaking of Burt, now at New York Comic Con, we were sitting there, as you may remember,
yeah.
and you did mention that you said that there was the possibility of some more Robin in your future. What can you tell us?
Don't have anything definitive at this time. And I would certainly have to take into account that if something happens, I would have to wait until a studio made that prior announcement.
Fair enough.
Never be so presumptuous to jump in ahead of time. And that would be a big no-no.
Gotcha.
But I can tell you that if our current movie does as well as I think it is, and people seem to really enjoy it. And by the way, did you hear the panel that I did with William Shatner while I was there at that thing? I'm not sure you were able to get into that at the same time.
No, because the timing, the way they had us overlapping between the interview room, it was really frustrating because last year, for the first movie, they had it timed perfectly. They took us downstairs,
right,
and then we watched the movie, and then there was the panel. So it didn't work out this year. But I'll tell you what, Burt, just as an aside to listeners here, Burt is going to be attending East Coast Comic Con in April of this year. And I'm actually going to be moderating the panel. So
nice.
That'll be great. That'll be great.
Yeah, that'll be a lot of fun.
I want to mention about this panel that we did at the New York Comic Con. I sat next to William Shatner, and I talked about the possibility of doing another major project. And he chimed in when the audience asked him about him doing another project. He chimed in and said, maybe Burt and I'll do a project together. So you never know what the future will hold, but I had met Bill many times at these events, but this is the first time at the New York Comic Con where we had a chance to talk together, and we got along famously. In fact, the panel that we did is, I think, on YouTube, which is readily accessible, and you can see the hilarious back and forth that he and I had, kind of similar to my relationship with Adam. We just got along really, really well. And gosh, Shatner's amazingly talented, just amazing guy.
Burt, you've been terrific as always. Really looking forward to the exhibit and looking forward to seeing you out in California next week. And I just want to know if there's anything else you wanted to say about the exhibit before we wrap things up.
Well, I think it's going to be a spectacular exhibit. And I think you want to come out and make sure you have a good appetite so you can get one of my Burt Ward Super Wiener bat hot dogs. And we'll all have a great time, guys. We'll have fun.
Fantastic.
Sounds great. Well, That's going to do it then for this episode of the Batcave podcast. Stay tuned, folks. Dan and I are continuing our look at the Filmation 1968 cartoon series that clearly had ties to Batman 66. Plus, Jim Beard and I will be wrapping up our look at the Green Hornet television series. That's all coming along on the Batcave podcast. So until next time, folks, thank you so much for listening. Once again, Bert, Dan, take care, everybody.
To the Batmobile, citizens!
Thanks for listening, chums. I don't have a bat phone, but you can contact the Batcave podcast through its Facebook page, Twitter, email at thebatcavepodcast@gmail.com. Subscribe to the podcast via Libsyn.com. That's Libsyn.com. Or through iTunes. The Batcave Podcast is part of a series of pop culture podcasts from the Chronic Rift Network. Find them at ChronicRift.com. So until next time, citizens, same bat time, same Batcave Podcast.